Kembo, Kembo, Natata Nzambi, Yamazulu. Glory to the Most High Yah who is in heaven. Today, we will be speaking a little bit about the faces of Africa, but more about the rich, hidden history of Congo. The three faces of Africa, really people, I should say, are the Nilots, which are Hamites, particularly what people call Egyptians. The second face, we will be speaking about the Cushites. These are where Nebuchadnezzar, somebody like Nipsey Hussle, he was a Cushite from the territory of Iturea. And we will be speaking about the Bantus, and their rich history, where they come from, and just the territories. And we'll be speaking a little bit about the territory of each face, each people. As I said before, the Nilotes, they are Hamitic people, so they inherited Egypt and Nubia. Their territories, the biblical territory of each face, so to speak, each people, is bigger, more expansive than what the world says it is today. Like, for instance, people see Ethiopia and they think that only the modern country of Ethiopia was the territory of Kush, and that is incorrect. The territory of the Bantus, the territory of the Kushites, the territory of the Nilotes is much bigger than what is shown on the world maps today. So we will be speaking a little bit about each face, but as I said before, this video is more about the rich history, the hidden history of Congo. The first face, or the first people that we will be speaking about, are the Cushites. The Cushites, or the Cushitic peoples, are a grouping of people who are primarily indigenous to Northeast Africa, the Nile Valley, or the Horn of Africa, and speak or have historically spoken Cushite languages. Ethio-Shemitic, which is Ethiopia and Shem, languages of the Afro-Asiatic language family. Cushite languages are spoken today primarily in the Horn of Africa, in Djibouti, Eritrea, Ethiopia, Somalia. These are Cushite territories, as well as the Nile Valley in South Sudan and Egypt. Notice that the Cushites and the Nilotes, they are brothers. Notice that, and you will see when we get to the Nilote slide, we'll see that these two are in fact brothers. They share the same father, the Cushites and the Nilotes. So it says, in parts of the African Great Lakes region, Tanzania and Kenya, while the Ethio-Shemitic languages are spoken in the Horn of Africa and sparsely in the Nile Valley. Some examples of these peoples include the Afar, the Beha, Oromo, Somali, Amhara, and the Tigrayans, or Tigrayans. That's, hold on to that name, because that's the Tigris River. That's funny. But remember that. And this is the Garages and the Sadama. People of, among several others. So these are all cool shots. And we are going to show you examples of what the Kushites look like. Here is a Kushite man. Notice that their noses are narrow. Their noses are very narrow, and if you was living in our community, in the Bantu community, they would say that this person has good hair. It's nice and wavy, but you still see that he is a dark-skinned person. There was never any dispute over the Kushites. The Kushites were always known as dark-skinned people without question. So when we see movies in Hollywood and we see Egyptians somehow light-skinned, but then they portray Kushites as dark-skinned people, we know there's something wrong with that, because these two people, they came from the same father. They came from the same father. They're both dark-skinned people, and we are going to see in the description that that was written about the history of these places. They were called the Land of the Dark Faces. So we see an example why, and this is the first example of an Ethiopian man, or a Kushite man, excuse me. And notice his nose is narrow in the middle, and they have nice hair, wavy hair. Now here is another example of a Kushite woman. And notice how her nose is narrow. Their cheekbones are kind of high, and they have nice wavy hair. These are Kushites. And it's helpful to be able to identify Kushites, not to say for any type of racism. This is strictly for identification and informational purposes only. This is not for trying to put one group down or do anything like that. We are simply speaking on Kushites, the Nilotes, and the Bantus, their history, what they look like, and bits and pieces of their culture. Now here's the final example of another Kushite. Notice again the narrow nose, the nice hair, and the brown skin. And there is a verse in Amos that compares what the Kushites look like and what the Israelites look like in the eyes of the Most High. I don't want to say it yet, but we're going to get to it later. Amos chapter 9, verse 7. I'm pretty sure people are familiar with it, but now we are just seeing examples with it in our own eyes, with our own eyes. Now we are moving on to the Nilotes. The Nilotic people are people indigenous to the Nile Valley who speak Nilotic languages, which constitute a large subgroup of the Nilo-Saharan, languages spoken in South Sudan, Uganda, Kenya, and North Tanzania. In a more general sense, the Nilotic people include all descendants of the original Nilo-Saharan speakers. These are Egyptians. The seed of Ham, which we will get to later. Among these are the Luo, the Maasai, the Kalenjin, the Dinka, the Nuer, the Chaluk, Ateker, and the Maa-speaking peoples, each of which is a cluster of several ethnic groups. So these are a cluster, a different variety of ethnic groups. So I would say there's Put, there's Canaan, and there's Ham, or Mitzrayim, Egypt, whatever you want to call. There's a cluster of different groups. Some ethnic groups in West Africa, such as the Seyer people of Senegal, and in Gambia and Mauritania, have been reported as being of Nilotic origin. So all these Nilotes, these are without question coming from the Nile Valley in Egypt. They're the original Egyptians. They are the original children of Mitzrayim, the children of Ham. This is the first example of a Nilot man, a true what they call Hamite or Egyptian, and they are noticed by their dark skin, their broad noses, and most of them as a people are about 6 foot. They're, I guess, on average the tallest people on earth, and obviously they are one of the biggest groups in the faces of Africa. And yeah, they if you just read, they are from the Nile Valley in the Northeast Africa area and goes as far as the west coast of Africa. So those that let you know, that's all Hamite territory. And now we are going to get to some more examples. Here is an example of a Nilot woman. And Nilots are said to be very nomadic people, very, what do you call it, strong-willed people. It is also been said of them, as they are the original Egyptians, that tribes like the Dahomey tribe, which are Egyptians, they are, I want to say, they're not snake worshippers, but they believe that the snake has a lot of power. And as I said, they're nomadic people. They have many different deities that they call upon, but these are, without a doubt, being from the Nile Valley in that area, the original Hamites. Here is the final example of Nilot people. They are said to be a very proud people. They are hold fast to their traditions. So things that you read about the Egyptians doing in the Bible, it is said that these people hold fast to their traditions. So yeah, this is the final example. So now we're going to be moving on to the Bantu. The Nilotes constitute the majority of the population in South Sudan, which is ancient Namibia, an area that is believed to be their original point of dispersal. After the Bantu peoples, they constitute the second most numerous group of peoples inhabiting the African Great Lakes region around the Eastern Great Rift. They make up a notable part of the population in southwestern Ethiopia as well, because they are brothers with the Kushites. And they, it is believed to be that Namibia, which is a part of ancient Egypt, South Sudan, and obviously North Sudan, it's these are Egyptians, the Nilotes. As we saw before, the Nilotes, after the Bantus, are the second largest group in Africa. And here are examples of Nilotes, and all Nilotes are Hamites by origin. The Nilotes, or Nilotic, a language family that is subset to Austenitable Eastern Sudanic family, which is a subset of the Nilo-Saharan language family. Dinkas, Nuers, Kalenjins, Luos are examples of Nilotes. The Yorubas belong to the Nilotes, but not Bantus. People who speak Yoruba and identify as Yoruba, they speak a Volta-Kongo language as well, and speak a language that appears to be fairly, but certainly not very, closely related to the next group in the series. They live mostly in southwest Nigeria, but also in parts of Benin and Togo, as we saw before that the Nilotes, their, I don't want to say their kingdom, but their peoples extend all the way to the west coast of Africa. They're mostly Christian in this time and age, but there's a large majority of them that are Muslim. Igbos are also Nilotes. They identify, they are the same as the Yoruba people. The people who speak Igbo and identify as Igbo, their language shares a lot of similarities with the Yoruba language. They come from southeast Nigeria, and they're mainly Christian nowadays in that region, after the colonization, obviously. But they are, by origin, Nilotes, Hamites. There have been a few instances where people have been saying that the Yoruba are Bantus, and you can look right here and see with yourself, see by yourself, that the Yoruba are not Bantu. The Bantu's language family is Bwene Congo, and the Yoruba, like the Nilotes, they belong to Niger Congo. And if anybody knew the history of Africa, the differences between the faces of Africa, the Bantus and the Nilotes and the Kushites, they are not the same people. Even though the Kushites and the Nilotes share a father, their kingdoms are separate. And they all have different facial features, as we have seen and will see, because we haven't gotten to the Bantus yet. But yeah, the Yoruba, they are Nilotes. The Yoruba are not Bantu. Yoruba belongs to the Niger-Congo family of languages. Most Yoruba speakers live in West Africa, which is, as we read before, where some of the Nilotic people, they extended to. Nations of Nigeria and Benin, there are about 40 million people who have Yoruba as a first language. And that makes perfect sense, because they are the second largest group in Africa after the Bantu. Here we can visually see the difference between the Yoruba, who are Nilotes, and the Bantu, who are Hebrews. The Yoruba, like their Egyptian past says, they have many different deities. There's Ajay, something of wealth. You see all these. I don't even want to have these names on my lips. But these are the different deities of the Yoruba. And not only do they have these deities, they practice what is called Vodun, which is the same thing as voodoo. And we all know that voodoo is witchcraft, it's sorcery, whatever you want to call it. And these are things that are openly practiced by the Yoruba, in even in the Caribbean and Brazil, all the way obviously in Africa, where they got it from. It's the home of all this, all these multiple deities that they have, as opposed to the Bantus, who have one sovereign master, which whom they call Nzambi. He created the earth and withdrew from the world. Obviously, when you read the book of Hosea, it's for our own sins that he withdrew his face from the world. Nzambi Mbugu, which means God Almighty in Kikongo, remains responsible for rainfall and health. Just like when you read the book of Matthew, it says that in a KJV or whatever text you want to use, it says God makes it rain upon the good and the bad. Well, this is a Bantu belief that Nzambi, God Almighty, remains responsible for rainfall and health. So it is he who kills and makes alive, as it says in the book of Deuteronomy. These are Bantu theologies, and this is Bantu culture. Now here it says Congo, but later on you will see in this presentation that all Bantu people are Congo. So it says in the Congo, quote unquote, religion is based on a broad set of traditional beliefs from the Kikongo-speaking peoples. The faith bases itself in the idea that the main creator, God, named Nzambi Mpugu, which means God Almighty in Kikongo, who made the world and the spirits who inhabit it. So this is where the Portuguese got their ideas from, because we already had our own creator, the Most High, Nzambi Mpugu, who created all spirits, who created all flesh. And like I was said in the previous slide, he withdrew from the world, and all Congo knows this. The priestly doctors known as Nganga try to heal followers with mind and bodies, and these people are people used herbs, and obviously we prayed, and obviously we offered sacrifices to the Most High, Yah. So the Congo people and the Congo faith of a single creator is not anything new. It's not what do you call it, people trying to infuse African ideas with the Bible. This is what it is. This is what it always has been. And the Congo people, or the Bantu people, have been, this has been our faith since the beginning. The Bantu people, the Bantus, are speakers of the two languages, comprising several hundreds of indigenous ethnic groups in sub-Saharan Africa. For example, the Xhosa, the Zulu, the Chiluba, the Congo. There are many different ethnic groups, all of which are Bantu, all of which are Hebrew, that spread over a vast area from Central Africa to the African Great Lakes to South Africa. which is like the Limba. Linguistically, these languages belong to southern Bantoid branch of Bwene Congo, one of the language families grouped with the Niger Congo phylum. So the Bwene Congo has been grouped in with the Niger Congo, and the Niger Congo is the Yoruba and the Nanas. They have been grouped in together, but obviously they are different people. They look different and they have different beliefs and different DNA. Here is the first example of a Bantu brother. And when compared to the Kushites, you see that the Bantu noses are wider than the Kushite noses, but flatter than the Nilot noses. And subtle differences like that will help you identify who is who when you are out in the real world. The Kushites, they have flat, thin noses. Their nostrils don't flare out as much as the Nilots and the Bantus. And the Nilots, they have the largest nose out of all. Their noses, they flare up, their nostrils flare up, and they have wide noses. But the Bantus, they have wide noses, but it's flat when compared to the Nilots, and it's obviously not as big as the Kushite nose. Now again, as we look at this Bantu sister, notice the difference. The Kushite woman, her cheekbones are a lot higher than this Bantu sister, and the Kushite woman, her nose is a lot less wide than this Bantu sister. You see and then with her nose, as compared to the Nilots, her nostrils are not as flared out, and it's flatter than the nose of the Nilots. And you just see the differences between the Bantus, the Kushites, and the Nilots. Even though all these three different people, which constitute a big portion of the continent of Africa, it's clearly visible in their faces and in their DNA that they are different peoples with different cultures, and we should recognize that and not be so, closed-minded when we look at the continent of Africa. We shouldn't be quick to say everybody is Hamites on that continent. That's just not true. The Bantus, which are Hebrews, are in that continent. The Kushites, even though they're brothers to the Nilots, the Hamites, the Egyptians, they still have different features, and they share customs with the Egyptians, but they are they're their own people separately, respectively. Finally, here we have a young Bantu brother, and again you see the differences between the nose and the cheeks. And I don't want to beat a dead horse, but it's just clear to see. This is a young brother, obviously without his beard, he hasn't grown it yet, but you see the differences between the Nilots, the Kushites, and the Bantus.
Kazoid for Africa. My friend Michelle, who's African American, asked me a really good question the other day, and she was like, she wanted to understand herself as an African American and connect with her African roots. And I'm seeing like a lot of African Americans now are really connecting with us as Africans, which is super great. And they're asking questions and they want to know what we know. So she wanted to know, if she was a Bantu, if she was a Nilot, or if she was a Kushite. So it's very interesting. So I gave her that whole thing that, you know, we as Africans, you know, learn in school, you know, about the three African groups. And so she was fascinated because she didn't learn about that, about, you know, her people. So I'm going to give you a quick rundown on who the Bantus are, the Nilots and the Kushites, and I'm going to put information bar below so that you can read about them, and maybe this Kwanzaa you could like take a quick look and ask yourself, you know, who you could be. And I just said Kwanzaa because it's that time of year, it's the holidays, and it's cozy, and I love doing videos over the fall. Anyway, let me get right to it. Bantus. So the Bantu group, I am actually a Bantu. So one of the things, we are the biggest group in Africa. So about I would say 70 to 80% of Africans are in the grouping of the people called Bantu. And what's great about Bantus is that we're characteristics with our broad noses, and we have dark skin. Some Bantus tend to have some lighter skins, but the features of the facial structure remain the same. And we also speak related languages as well. And so in almost every part of Africa, you're gonna find a lot of Bantu speaking people. And I'll put in like a little picture so you can kind of see a different group of Bantus. And then now we'll move on to the Nilots. So the Nilots are also a grouping in Africa. One of the things I learned about the Nilots is that they tended to be very nomadic people. So they move from different parts of Africa to the other. And they also tend to really, really value cattle. And examples of Nilots, especially from my country, are like the Maasai, the Luos. Those are two different groups within my country. And one example of a Nilot is actually Lupita Nyong'o. She's of the Nilotic tribe. And so it's a great, great group of people, and they have a great history. And so that would be the second grouping. And now I'm going to move on to the third and final grouping of Africans, and that's the Kushites. And so the Kushites are known by, their features are very different. I would say their features tend to be very Western type features. Normal countries where Kushites traditionally are like in East Africa, we have the Ethiopians and Eritreans. Those are examples of Kushites. We have also the Moroccans. And the model Iman is actually an example of a Kushite African. And their hair texture tends to be a little bit different. Their skin color tends to be a little bit different on the fairer side. And they tend to have a little bit of pointed noses features as well. And so that's it. Those are the three groupings. So that's.
Now let us talk about some biblical stuff and mix it with the old maps. Now let's see for certain where some of these ancient places are located according to ancient cartographers, people who drew maps and whatnot. And we are going to couple that with sources from Google and whatever whatnot, and prove without a doubt that the biblical land of what you see before you, Shinar and Babylon, Hamath and all Babylonian territories, are actually south of the land of Egypt, modern day Egypt. And it's actually even south of Egypt still, because Namibia is Egypt. It's just southern Egypt, but it's now called South Sudan. So we see here the land of Shinar, which can be found in Genesis chapter 10 and Genesis chapter 11, which is the land where all people came from when they came from Babel Mandel. it is the land where the well, all the languages were, what do you call it, confused and separated in a split of tongue. This is where this happened. It's south of Egypt, near Babylon, in Kushite territory. And this map, coupled with the scripture, we can see that Shinar is precisely where our ancestors went when they were when the languages were being separated by the Most High Yah. They went in this area, southern Namibia, or South Sudan, which is north of Abyssinia, which is this is modern day Kenya, or in the Ethiopia area. And if you see here closely, this land was also called Susa, which can be found in the Book of Esther. And this was all taking place by the Tigris River, which is also called Hiddekel, and this is in Africa. So there should be no confusion, really, because there are a lot of people who believe that modern day Iraq is where ancient Babylon is found, and we are going to prove with maps and with scripture that's just not true. Again, here on this map, we see the land of Shinar, or Susa, in South Namibia, which is modern day South Sudan, next to Abyssinia, modern day Kenya and Ethiopia area. And we see the Tigris River again, right here, nowhere near what they say Iraq or whatever. The Tigris River, according to ancient maps, pre-colonization, the Tigris River is in Africa. Again, here, next to ancient Namibia and ancient Abyssinia, we have the Tigris River flowing through the land of Africa, Al-Kabulan. Just one more time, in ancient Abyssinia, modern day Ethiopia, we have the Tigris River flowing through East Africa. Now, according to the Ancient Encyclopedia, this website, I'll give anyone the link if they want it, the city of Shinar was also known as the island of Miro. And I will show the maps to verify this. And it was right next to Babylon, which is coming up. It says, as the waters flowing around it made it so. It is referenced in the biblical book of Genesis 10 verse 6 as Ethiopia, a name applied to the region of South Egypt, South Namibia, in antiquity, meaning place of the burnt faces. This is South Egypt, and this is Ethiopia, Mero. This is a Kushite territory, the land of the black faces, burnt faces, excuse me. So there's no question about what color the people are in this land. In Egypt and in Ethiopia, they got burnt faces. They're all black people. Although there is evidence of overgrazing and overuse of the land, which caused considerable problems, Moreau thrived until it was sacked by a Kusamite king in 330 CE and steadily declined afterwards. Now, also according to this article, the land of Shinar, also known as Meroe, it had Egyptian influence, and this king Ergamenes, these are Kushite people, but they have ties to the Egyptians. Now it says, while there was a settlement at Meroe as early as 890 BCE, the earliest tomb was discovered there, that of Lord A, dates from that year. The city flourished at its height between 750 BCE and 350 BCE. The kingdom of Kush, founded with its capital at Napata, was ruled by Kushites, called Nubians by the Egyptians, who early on continued Egyptian practices and customs, and though they were depicted in art as distinctly Kushite, called themselves by Egyptian titles. The historian Mark Van de Merup writes the following. Meroitic, aka Kushitic culture, shows much Egyptian influence, always mixed with local ideas. Many temples house cults to Egyptian deities like Amun, they called it Amanu, and Isis, which is where Easter comes from. It's the deity of fertility or whatever. But indigenous deities received royal patronage as well. A very prominent Nubian deity was the lion deity, Apodemic, a deity of war whose popularity increased substantially in this period. Local deities were often associated with Egyptian ones. In Lower Numidia, or Lower Egypt, the deity Mandulis, for example, was considered to be Horus's son, and Horus's Egyptian deity. Hybridity is also visible in the arts and royal ideology. For example, the kings of Meroe were represented in monumental images on temples in Egyptian fashion, but with local elements such as garments, crowns, and weapons. We see here clearly Meroe, or what was also called Shinar, next to Babylon, and it was called Ethiopia. Like how it said in the article, Genesis 10, chapter 6, or verse 6, excuse me. And this is in Africa. This is the Tigris River flowing down. Babylon, Shinar, or ancient Meroe. And we'll see with the statues or the columns and all the pyramids, everything that they did, just like their Egyptian brothers, because hey, they were family. Again, we see Meroe next to Babylon, in what was called Ethiopia and so-called modern-day Egypt. You see here, this is the Tigris River that flows down that we've seen on the other maps. And Meroe, or what is also called Shinar and Babylon, is indeed in the continent of Africa. Now on this map, we see Babylon standing by its own. But regardless, we see that it is clearly in Africa, in what they call Egypt, Lower Egypt, what was called Namibia back in the day. And Namibia is key because through Namibia, our people come to the Bakongo. Share a little bit about their history. Again, here we have a clear, cut and dry, plain as day source that tells us exactly where Babylon is and was. It was at the boundary between Lower and Middle Egypt. Lower and Middle Egypt, not Iran, where the river craft paid tolls when ascending or descending the Nile. Diodorus ascribes the erection of the first fort to rebel Assyrian captives in the reign of Sesostris and Stias, or whatever how you say this person's name. Persica dates it to the time of Semiramis, but Josephus, with the greater probability, attributes it to the structure to some Babylonian followers of Cambyses. Remember this name, because the Congolese know this name, and they know that this is where, when they came from, and they came from this person's reign in this area. In 525 BC, the Romans built a new fortress near the river with typically Roman red and white banded masonry. Remember that. But back in the day, this was the Babylonian fortress, and it was in Egypt. Shown in Egypt. At the Babylonian fortress, and it's not even a question. Here is a physical representation of what the article was speaking about. How ancient Meroe, this ancient Kushite, aka Babylonian city, did customs and built their things according to the manner of the Egyptians, their brothers. And their neighbors, really. So, we can just look and see how barren and dry, arid this place is. Nobody walks through on foot and through this place. It's a hot place. It's desert. There's no water around unless you bring your own water on foot. And good luck walking through that. Good luck walking through this place that the Most High has condemned forever. Who can make water come from this place? Ancient Babylon, just like how Jeremiah the prophet said, it's been taken. Their idols have been overthrown, smashed to pieces. Look. And see the word of the Most High Yah, how it comes to its finish. As we saw in the article, the Kushites, the Babylonians, or the people of Meroe, they had a deity to which they modeled after a lion. And you see all in their history, the path of their history, which has been wiped out by the Most High Yah, for the punishment that Babylon has did to the children of Israel, Yisraele or Yesolele, is that they've been laid waste. It's barren, as he said it would be, but you see they have all their lions that they had set up. And their temples, that the remains or ruins of their temple walls that used to stand, and this place used to be thriving back in the day. It used to be next to a river. It's a place of commerce. But when the Most High speaks, it will be done. Here are a couple ruins of the ancient Babylon, ancient Meroe city. I'm guessing that these were their temples, their places of worship, where they would go and place their deities and bow before them and offer sacrifices and do all that whatnot. And for their idolatry, they have received their just punishment from the Creator of all things. He who is the maker of all things. He has spoken, and it's just a sight to behold, to see how the Creator, the invisible Creator, his word has become manifested, and we can see it plain as day, to this place that used to have rivers around it and was a thriving city full of commerce, trade, and whatever. And now it has been reduced to nothing. Here lies the remains of these Babylonian deities, who look just like their Egyptian deities, besides, like I would say, the crowns and all the weapons and the stuff that they had craved in it to mark its Babylonian or Kushite ideology, but it looks very similar to the Egyptian deities because they are brothers. They just like added some level of royalty to the deities that already were and called it Kushite. But they, it's set in stone forever as a memorial for these people, but nobody passes through and nobody is going to walk on foot to see, or not many people are there. I'm sure there are tourists who go through and try to see what they can and take pictures, obviously, otherwise I wouldn't have this, but nobody really, it's not the city of commerce how it used to be, because the Most High spoke and that place is dry. As we can see here, the Nubian people are an ethnic group which originated in present-day Egypt and Sudan. These are Hamitic people. Nubian people are one of the most ancient civilizations in Africa. Today, Nubian people live spread across South Egypt and North Sudan, established on the shores of the Nile River. Nubians, they are an ethno-linguistic group of Africans indigenous to present-day Sudan and South Egypt, who originate from the early inhabitants of the Central Nile Valley, believed to be one of the earliest cradles of civilization. So these are talking about the Hamitic people, these are talking about Kushites and their brothers, the Nilotic people, or what is called the Egyptians, the Canaanites, but and just children of Ham. So these are genetically one of the oldest people on the earth.
Où ils sont restés pour une longue durée et où ils ont créé le Congo Diampangala. Le Congo Diampangala était la première pierre sur laquelle ils avaient construit le Congo.
Les Bakongo sont comme les grands, comme toutes les grandes civilisations africaines, proviennent de l'Égypte antique, et on pense que c'est après l'occupation de l'Égypte antique par Cambyse, que les populations noires ont commencé à quitter l'espace de l'Égypte antique et qu'il y a une partie de ces populations qui s'est retrouvée dans la région occupée par les Bakongo.
Ce que Le peuple Congo vient de la vallée du Nil. Il y a eu une migration qui est partie de la vallée du Nil, qui est descendue donc, du côté est de l'Afrique, donc dans les actuels pays qu'on appelle le Rwanda, le Burundi, le Kenya, la Tanzanie, la Zambie, le Zimbabwe, l'Afrique du Sud, la Namibie, qui est remontée parce que, vous savez, nous on pense que les migrations se font comme ça. Non, les ancêtres étaient en train de chercher une terre qui donne le maximum d'énergie, c'est-à-dire des rapports avec l'immanent, donc avec Dieu.
Many people are not aware of this, but the Democratic Republic of Congo is widely considered to be the richest country in the world, not just Africa, but in the entire world regarding natural resources. It is untapped deposits of raw minerals are estimated to be in worth in excess of $24 trillion U.S. dollars. So the DRC, the Congo, is, I want to say, infinitely richer than the U.S., but I mean, these numbers ain't lying. The United States has nothing like this. So for the people who be thinking that America is the Holy Land, get real. There's no lions, tigers, and bears over here. The wildlife of Africa, specifically even the Congo, come on, that lets you know that David, while David was fighting a bear or a lion with his bare hands, he wasn't doing that nowhere in America. It's in Africa, in places like the Congo, to where that's all the gold and all the just the richness that the Most High put upon us, because he put us in a land where these things were to be found, in the richest place on the whole earth, the throne of the whole earth. It's found nowhere else but the Congo. The Book of Jubilees makes it clear, along with all these other sources, facts, and details that show that Central Africa is actually the home of the Jews. The Congo is actually the Holy Land. Mount Zion is actually in modern-day Kenya, and it's called Mount Kenya. And these other mountains are just happen to be in the vicinity, and they happen to form a triangle between themselves, as if this is the apple of his eye. And he knew that the Garden of Eden is the Holy of Holies, the dwelling of Yah, and Mount Sinai, the center of the desert, and Mount Zion, the center of the navel of the earth, where Kenya is, near the equator. These three were created as holy places facing each other. Mount Kenya, Mount Zion, excuse me. Then we have the mountain in the center of the desert, Mount Sinai. And then we have this mountain. Just south of Kenya in Tanzania, three mountains
facing each other, created as holy places, set apart places for the Most High to look upon his throne at the center of the whole earth.
Here again, we have a map in the 1700s, pre-colonialism, what is modern day Kenya. We have Jericho and we have Gilgal. And obviously in the book of Joshua, this is where Joshua was right before he went into the land. This is 1700 along with the 1500 record from Richard Whiteway from the Portuguese people when they were in Abyssinia and they were near the Jews Amba, the Jews Mountain in Abyssinia. Modern day Kenya, modern day Ethiopia.
This is around the time where our people were going into captivity. It was common knowledge where the Jews Mountain was. It was common knowledge that Mount Zion was Mount Kenya. And people knew this. So it's time to wake up. Muhammad Ghani, the terrible Moorish general, was in the province of Tigray. He was in the province near the Tigris River, near Babylon. Prepared to dispute the advance of the Portuguese, which were coming, they came for the Congo, right? They came to the Congolese people to try to enslave us, and they did. With 1,000 horse, 5,000 foot soldiers, 50 Turkish musketeers, aka Ashkenazi people, and some artillery. And Degama's army consisted of 450 Portuguese people and about 12,000 Abyssinians. So that's Kushites, Egyptians, Canaanites, these were Abyssinians, people within the Hamitic family, badly armed with spears and shields, but his own energy and dash at first carried all before him. So he was fighting with courage, whatever. He took to the main mountain fortress of Ambazane by storm, and during April 1542, defeated Grani in two pitched battles. He afterwards crossed the Takazi River and surprised the famous hill fortress known as the Jews' Amba. Amba means mountain, so it's the Jews' Mountain in Abyssinia, which is modern-day Kenya, modern-day Ethiopia. But during the winter, Grani received reinforcements. In August 28, 1543, he defeated the Allied army in a pitched battle. Badly wounded, the Gama was with difficulty prevailed on to accompany the Queen Mother and the rest in their flight, and lagging behind was captured by Moors and beheaded. Only 300 out of the 450 Portuguese escaped from this fatal battle. They retreated to the Jews' Mountain in Abyssinia, in modern-day Kenya and modern-day Ethiopia, where they were joined by the Negus, Claudius, in February 1544, and gained a brilliant victory over the Mohammedans. These are so-called Arabs, Muslim people, in which Grani himself was shot by a musketeer. The Negus, the Jews, the Bantus, was eventually slain in battle by the Mohammedans of Adel in March 1559, and his bodyguard of 18 Portuguese were killed to a man in their gallant attempt to defend him. Yet the Portuguese were treated with the basest ingratitude. They married natives, and Dr. Becky tells us that to this day their descendants are called Francis at Pereno and in its vicinity.
Have you learned something I'm going to say about mentally the shows of combat dans l'ensemble? Le plateau du Rang du Congo, qui est le bazar combattoir, nous y trouvons 12 sources d'eau. C'est-à-dire ce sont des sources d'eau. Ils sont 12. Et les 12 identifient les 12 tribus qui ont créé en ces rangs. Et le fondateur l'ont appelé Mbanzaya Kongo. Mbanzaya Kongo, Kandaya Kongo. C'est-à-dire Mbanzaya Kongo, Kandaya Kongo. Aujourd'hui, on comprend que Mbanzaya Kongo, c'est-à-dire l'ensemble, la capitale du Congo. Kandaya Kongo, c'est-à-dire la grande famille du Congo. Mais je veux retourner sa signification. Quand ils ont fondé le rang du Congo, ils étaient à quatre grandes provinces. Congolien Bangala au sud, Congolien Mulaza à l'est, et Congolien Bandu au nord. Et ceux qu'ils ont créés, ils ont appelé Citadianza. C'est-à-dire Congolien Bangala, Congolien Mulaza, Congolien Bandu et Congolien Citadianza. Donc ce sont les quatre grandes provinces qui constituent le royaume du Congo. Et Mbanzaton se trouve à Citadianza, où on trouve 12.
There are to be remarked in the language of the Negroes many turns of phrases which appear to be Hebrew. We have observed that they express, like the latter, by substantives, the qualities of a person or thing which are rendered by adjectives in other languages. Thus, in order to say hot water, they say water of fire. Mazia ma mbazu. They say also a man of blood for a cruel man, a man of riches for a rich man, and so forth. They never express the affections of love or hatred, joy, or affliction by present tense, but by preterites, like the Hebrews. They say, I have loved, I have hated, for I love and I hate. So it is pretty clear to say, pretty obvious to say that even in the 1500s, while our people were going into captivity, while they were fighting us, they knew exactly who they were fighting. They came down to Abyssinia, modern day Kenya, and Ethiopia area, and they came to fight against the so-called Niggas, the Bantus, the people of Congo, and they called them Jews. And sure enough, they took us into slavery because the Most High said that we would go into captivity because of our sins before him. But again, here is another Portuguese, Abbe Poirier. He wrote about when he went down into Luango, which is a piece of Congo, and he spoke about our language and how it resembled Hebrew, because this is Hebrew, because they're going to fight against the Jews at the Jews Mountain in Abyssinia. So let's just read what the Portuguese man had to say. They're also found in language many words pretty much resembling Hebrew words, and which have the same signification in Hebrew. Bana, which is children, and in the so-called modern Hebrew, it's Ben, and it means son. Signifies he has built, because they have considered the children as living stones, which composed the edifice of the family. In Kikongo, Mania signifies stones, and Bana, children. Tamer means a rule or a measure, and in the Hebrew, Taman or Thamam means funnels or perfection. So that shows similarity right there. In the language of the Negroes or Kikongo, means the lower parts, the foundation, and so-called modern Hebrew, Issa, or which is also written as Asha, signifies lower part or foundation. Koma in Kikongo means to approach or to meet, and the so-called modern Hebrew, Kum, means to rise up or to go out and meet. And in Kikongo, Lika means to eat, and the so-called modern Hebrew, Lakam, means to eat, or it's written Lakam, it means the same thing. And the so-called modern Hebrew, Likam or Lakam, means bread. The letter H, as we have remarked, does not enter into pronunciation of these Africans, the Bantu, the people of Congo. The little practice which the compositors have in Hebrew does not permit us to augment, as we might easily do, the lip of similar words. So these are just a few words. They didn't go obviously into the full course to show how many Kikongo words are so-called similar to Hebrew words, because Kikongo is much older than modern Hebrew. And that's not anything that's debatable. It's a fact. There are also connections of this language, of Kikongo, with Greek, appear equally marked. Besides several constructions of similar phrases, there are, as we observe, several verbs which change the initials and take augments and double letters, as with the Greeks. And I don't want to read all that because it's a lot to read. But we can clearly see that Kikongo has a lot of influence in different languages. Kikongo is the base of all Bantu languages. And they say that Kikongo has similar words to to Hebrew, but what they really mean is Hebrew has, modern Hebrew has similar words to Kikongo, because Kikongo came first, and also Greek has similar words to Kikongo, because Kikongo came before so-called Greek. It really is one of the oldest languages there is. The Congo language, actually called Kikongo, that these people were so enamored by, they were so shocked to see that, wow, these people speak a language that's similar to Hebrew, as these people call it, but they live by the Jewish mountain. They live in the richest place on earth, and I don't need to say more. I'll just keep reading what it has to say, what the enemy has to say about the Congo or Kikongo language. It is one of the Bantu languages spoken by the Congo and Ndunu people living in the tropical forest of the Democratic Republic of Congo, the Republic of Congo, and Angola. It is a tonal language. It was spoken by many of those who were taken from the region and sold as slaves in the Americas. So this is talking about us, people like me, where when you take a DNA test, it says you're Bantu, and I have Congolese in my DNA and all that good stuff or whatever. To where this is clearly the language that our people were speaking when they came over and when they were singing our Negro spirituals. And this is clearly the language that our people were speaking when the Portuguese were in the land and they were by the Jewish mountain and they were in this rich land. And to this day, Congo still feeds the world, because people, when they want riches, they go to Africa, they rob Africa of its riches, and Congo is the richest place in Africa, in the whole world. So that is where the world is getting its resources from. From what Kempa Vita, a Congolese woman, and what the Book of Jubilees says is the Holy Land. They came to the Holy Land, the richest place, the most fertile place on earth, and they robbed it, they pillaged it, they plundered it, they took its people, they took everything. They didn't leave anything behind. But it's time for us to restore. This is what the Most High's clear message through Isaiah and all the later prophets. It's about restoration. It's about going home and rebuilding the old walls, the old things that were broken down, and living in peace until it's that time. Living in harmony until the time of war and, you know, all the things happen that are written to happen. Again, you can ask Google or whatever, what is Congo known for? Congo gained independence from the Belgium in 1960. Congo is rich in natural resources. It boasts vast deposits of industrial diamonds, cobalt, and copper, one of the largest forest reserves in Africa, and about half of the hydroelectric potential of the entire continent. It's in the Congo. That is where, when you go back and you think on the videos and you remember what the brother was saying, is that they had the Providence. They had North Congo, South Congo, East Congo, West Congo. They split it into four territories. And it was all representative of the 12 tribes, the 12 founders of Congo, who came down from Egypt in the Babylonian area and settled and thrive for centuries until the Portuguese came and plundered us. And they split it with the with the children of Zidon, they split it with the, it says, Egypt put Libya, they were helpers, with the Ashkenazi, obviously, because we were sold to the Greeks, and all these things happened. All these things took place, for the most part, in Congo. They took us from Congo, and they brought us to the slave coast, to the gate of no return in West Africa. It wasn't just straight going to the same place for centuries, because they came and got us for centuries. They sent other tribes, they sent these other black people in Africa to search for us, because we were spread. The Congo goes across the west coast all the way to the east coast of Africa, and even in South Africa, where the Limba are found. They had to go into the interior, and they had to get help to keep finding us. And this is our history. Ophir, which, if you read the scriptures, is known and renowned for its gold. There's no better gold on earth than the gold that's found in Ophir. Well, look and see just where it happens to be. In the Congo area, in Central Africa, Central to South Africa, is where Hiram got his gold from, and he brought it back to Solomon in the Abyssinia area, in the Kenya area, in the Jews Mountain area, where the Arabs and the all the Abyssinians, the children of Ham, were fighting against the Bantus, the people of Congo, the Nigas, just to take us into captivity, just to take our spoil, just to take all our gold and our diamonds, our cobalt, our copper, everything that was ours, that was given to us by the Most High God. They came and plundered. By the end of the 19th century, after they got done colonizing, pillaging, raiding, looting, doing whatever they wanted, the white conquest of what is today South Africa was practically complete. And the Ndebele of Shona, of what was then called Rhodesia, had also succumbed. As white settlers moved into the fertile lands north of Limpopo, they were astonished to discover stone buildings, old mine workings, in the most remarkable ruins known as Great Zimbabwe, the Great Zimbabwe Complex. These ruins had first been discovered by a German, Karl Mauck, in 1871. Immediately, Mauck declared his conviction that these ruins had been erected by Queen of Sheba and were, in fact, a copy of Solomon's temple in Jerusalem, and that this entire area was the Ophir of the Bible, Solomon's gold land. It stood to reason, therefore, that the Jews had once lived here, and within a short time, the Karakanga speaking Shona people, and specifically the Limba tribe, were being defined in precisely the same way as the Hottentots, the Xhosa, and the Zulus. One settler writer, Richard Nicklin Hall, wrote a book about Great Zimbabwe in which he devoted considerable space to Jewishness of the surrounding area, the surrounding populations. He made a list of 24 similarities of the customs and belief, and concluded, "Founding Africa we arrive at the great island of Madagascar. A considerable literature was produced in the 19th century on the supposed Jewish origin of some of the island's population. This literature entered the popular discourse but originated from scholars. One such was French Madagascar expert Alfred Grandier, another Augustus King, a one-time professor at Hindustani at the University College London. They both claimed that there were great links between Madagascar and the ancient Jews and the gold of Ophir, whence bought and by whom. King argued that Madagascar had been the offshore base for the colony of Havala, with Tarshish, its port of entry, and the Madagascar had links with ancient Israel's certainly as early as the time of Solomon, and possibly even during the reign of his father David. Grandier's monumental work of Histoire physique naturelle et politique de Madagascar, also published in 1901, made similar claims, arguing that the parts of the local population were descendants of Jewish settlers of biblical times. Such views continued to be expressed throughout the 20th century. A suggestion that substantial traces of Hebrew were to be found in Malagasy was made in Le Hebrew of Madagascar by Joseph Briant in 1946. So these people knew. This is in 1946. This is this so-called movement has been around for centuries because it's the truth. Only because of propaganda is it not accepted as it should be. A little further up the coast of Africa, the general discourse enthusiastically endorsed this idea and added, as we have seen, that the biblical land of gold, Havilah, was in fact a mineralized region between Zambezi and Limpopo, and that the ancient gold workings of this region were first opened and associated monuments erected by the South Arabian Himyarites, that is Arabs, followed in the time of Solomon by the Jews and the Phoenicians. So these people, it's not a clue. It's not a guess, I mean to say. They know who we are, where we come from, and what our lands are. They know this. We need to know it and teach it to our children.